46% of the world's population speaks an Indo-European language, making it by far the largest language family in the world. Indo-European languages are spoken today on every single continent, but before Columbian expansion, were confined to just Europe and West Asia. Yes, what you see before you is indeed true. Languages as seemingly diverse as Hindi, Farsi, Russian, Italian, and even English are in fact cousin languages. The tongues of Pakistan, Afghanistan, Greece, Armenia, Sweden, and Spain all share a common linguistic ancestor. You might be wondering why these gray pockets of non-Indo-Europeans in the middle of the map, like Hungary and Turkey. Well, this is due to invasions of tribes from Central Asia following the fall of the Roman and later Byzantine empires. Tribes who brought with them non-Indo-European languages. Yes, this does mean that Indo-European speakers have inhabited these regions long before the fall of Rome, even before the rise of Rome. Here is a map of Europe at around 400 BC, about when Socrates was on death row and when the Olmec culture in Mesoamerica came to an end. We see that Rome has not yet expanded beyond the Italian peninsula, and much of Europe belongs to the Celts, who spoke Celtic, an Indo-European language, and the mother of modern Welsh, Scots, and Irish Gaelic. So where did the Indo-European language come from, and how far back does it go? Ever since serious study on this subject began, about 200 years ago, scholars have been debating between a triad of hypotheses. The first, and formerly the most generally accepted, was the steppe hypothesis, which places the Indo-European hearth over the Pontic-Caspian steppe, 4000 BC. The second is the Anatolian hypothesis, which places the hearth over Anatolia. A notable third possibility places the Indo-European homeland sometime between 3000 and 4000 BC over the Armenian highlands or Armenian plateau, a distinct physiographic region of elevated plains, snow-capped mountains, and fast-flowing streams, including the headwaters of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. Now, up until recently, the only tools that scholars had at their disposal were those of comparative linguistics, anthropology, and archaeology, which left a lot of holes unfilled. The recent rise and availability of DNA analysis is beginning to fill some of those holes, and finally shed some light on a 200-year-old debate. A massive study involving the collaborative efforts of 39 geneticists and anthropologists from 8 different countries has declared, quote, "the Armenian Plateau hypothesis gains in plausibility," end quote. More recently, in his 2018 book, Who We Are and How We Got Here, David Reich stated, quote, "The most likely location of the population that first spoke an Indo-European language was south of the Caucasus Mountains, perhaps in present-day Iran or Armenia, because ancient DNA from people who lived there matches what we would expect for a source population." End quote. Other recent DNA studies have echoed these findings. Although not an expert in this field, I've always personally felt that placing the Indo-European homeland over the Armenian highlands just made sense. And this was one of the earliest centers of Neolithic developments, where we find some of mankind's earliest technologies, a region which features the earliest evidence of wheat domestication, which went on to become a staple of West Asian and European diets, a region with the oldest copper, bronze, and iron-making facilities, the oldest shoes ever unearthed, and some of the oldest stone circles, including Göbekli Tepe, a discovery which sent shockwaves throughout the anthropological world for its level of sophistication relative to its age. And for all you wine connoisseurs, the oldest winemaking facility, the Areni 1 cave complex, is also found in this region. Now, if history has taught us anything at all, it's that groups with more advanced technologies will almost always spread out and overrun those with less advanced technologies, and in the process will inevitably propagate their cultures over their subjects. Rarely does it happen the other way around. It was, after all, the Europeans' guns, germs, and steel which subdued the indigenous inhabitants of the Americas, the overwhelming majority of whom today have inherited European cultures and speak European languages. In that same vein, I would argue that the original Indo-European speakers must have spread out from the Armenian plateau out into Europe and Southwest Asia. It just seems unlikely that this culture could have originated anywhere else, given the great multitude of advanced technologies we find in that region around the same time of Indo-European diffusion. And as it turns out, recent developments in the study of DNA are beginning to substantiate my original hunch. It's interesting to think the language I'm using here right now to communicate with you can be traced back not just to Britain, but beyond the English Channel, 2,000 miles all the way across the European continent, and 4,000 years before Christ, to the Armenian Highlands.